All right, we're going to get started. Welcome, everybody. Sorry for that abrupt end to the music, but I do want to get started right on time. We have a lot to share with you this afternoon. And let's see, as I am doing this, I'm going to rely on one of my other co-hosts to be admitting people from the waiting room. So Karen, Kristen, Talia, if y'all can just keep an eye on the waiting room as we get started here. So I'm Caitlin Marquis, and I work at the Collaborative for Educational Services. I live in Holyoke, and I use she, her pronouns. And I just wanted to first open by saying I'm so excited to be here right now with everybody in this room, all of you together. And I just want to say, we're the ones we've been waiting for. This moment has been such a long time coming, and we've been working really hard as a group, as the Food Policy Council Startup Circle, to launch this Food Policy Council. And I think I speak for many of us when I say that seeing all of your faces here right now just makes all of that hard work feel totally worth it. So I'm going to walk through some important tech information before handing it over to Talia for introductions. And I just want to preface all of this information by saying that this will be a somewhat technologically complex meeting. So it will be interesting, and we're going to do our absolute best to make it all work. But I do just request some grace as we go along. If we face any tech glitches, just please hang in there and be patient. And we will try to get through them. So the first thing I wanted to say is that we have everyone in the room automatically set to mute, and we just ask you to stay on mute unless you're invited to unmute yourself. And this is just to encourage the best sound quality for everyone in the room. So if you do get muted by the host, just know that this is because your background noise is interfering with the audio quality. It's not that we don't want to hear from you. We always love hearing from you, but it just might be a sort of a tech fix to mute you. And I also want to say that one of the big values and practices that we bring into our work is language justice. And so in this spirit, we have two interpreters with us this afternoon, Giselle Torres and Marlene Aguila. I think I'm saying that right. We try to do this in all of our public meetings, and we're grateful for the technology and the skill of our interpreters that allows us to offer this meeting in both English and Spanish. So let's see, Giselle and Marlene, would you like to just unmute and introduce yourself so folks can see who you are?
Hi, everyone. So my name is Giselle, and I'm one of the interpreters here. Nice to meet you all.
Hello, my name is Marlene, and I will be one of your interpreters. I'm delighted to be here.
Thank you so much, Giselle and Marlene. So if you're joining from Zoom for desktop on a PC or an Apple computer, you should see a globe on the bottom of your Zoom screen that you can click on to choose your preferred language. So we have English or Spanish available for this meeting. So go ahead and do that. If you're joining from Zoom, the Zoom app on an Apple or Android phone, there should be three little dots you can click, and then language interpretation to choose your preferred language. So, and I always need to say this, even if you can hear me speaking in English right now, you still need to select English in order to hear all of the content of the meeting. So if you want to hear Spanish speakers in your native language, you need to make sure that you're on the English channel. And if you don't select a language, you just might miss some of the meeting content just because you have to be on a language channel to be able to hear interpretation. So if you're joining from a Chromebook, a phone with a Google operating system, or directly from your browser, you won't have access to the language channels. So if at this time you're able to switch to Zoom for desktop or the Zoom app on your Apple or Android phone, we just encourage you to do that so that you can access the interpretation options. And if you're not able to make this switch, just please stay with us because you'll still be able to hear and understand the majority of the meeting, and there just might be some content you miss if it's spoken in other languages, in Spanish specifically. Okay, so we will also be using the chat throughout this meeting, and I know a lot of us have been on Zoom for a long time now, so you might already know how to use the chat. But you can access it by clicking on the chat icon on the bottom of your Zoom screen. And I'm not totally sure where it is on your phone, but you should be able to find it. And if you've never used the chat before, just know that you can change who you're chatting with using the drop-down menu where you enter your text. So if you'd like everyone in the room to see your message, you can select everyone. And if you want to send a private message or a question to someone, you can select that person's name in the drop-down menu. And part of the reason I'm telling you this is because, for example, you might need to, send a private message to me or one of the other meeting hosts to let us know you're having an issue. So just keep an eye on who you're sending your messages to, as Zoom tends to default back to your last selection. So just make sure you are keeping an eye. So know that your chat message also will automatically send when you hit enter on your keyboard. And at this time, I'd like to ask anyone who's listening on the Spanish channel to go ahead and use the chat right now to send me a private message, and the message can be in Spanish, to let me know that you're on the Spanish channel. And this is just for the purpose of creating breakout rooms later in the meeting. It'll just help me to know who is speaking Spanish or who needs to have Spanish content in the room. You can also send me a private chat at any point throughout the meeting if you're having a technical issue, and I'll do my best to help you address your technical issue. So the last thing I want to say before I hand it over to my colleague Talia is that we know how hard it can be to sit and stare at a screen for 2 hours. Again, we've all been in the pandemic for a long time. We're all pretty burnt out on screen time. We empathize with that. So we do really ask you to please take care of your needs first and foremost in this space. If you need to get up, stretch, get a glass of water, stir the pot you're cooking dinner in, whatever you might need to do to support your health and energy, we just strongly encourage you to do that. So now I will pass it over to Talia for some introductions.
Thanks, Caitlin. Hello, everyone. I'm Talia. I work at the Collaborative for Educational Services. I live in Turner's Falls and I use they, them pronouns. This launch event is brought to you by the Hampshire County Food Policy Council Startup Circle. You'll hear more about what the Startup Circle is later in the meeting, but you'll also be hearing from Startup Circle members throughout this meeting. So we'd like to start off by having the Startup Circle partners introduce themselves to you. You've heard from me and Caitlin. So now I'll ask the rest of the Startup Circle to introduce themselves, and I'll be calling on folks. And first up is Andy.
Hi, everybody. My name is Andy Grant. I live in Amherst in a co-housing community, and I am privileged to be the sociocracy coach. Thank you.
Thanks, Andy. Next up is Casey.
Hi, I'm Casey. I've relocated to Hampshire County from Mississippi, where I worked on food sovereignty issues. Thank you.
Thanks, Casey. Next up is Kia.
I'm muted. Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Kia Alki. I live in Hampshire Heights in Northampton, Massachusetts, and I'm a founding member of the Startup Circle.
Thanks, Kia. Next up is Kristen.
Hi, everyone. So good to be here. My name is Kristen Whitmore. I use she, her pronouns, and I work at the Collaborative for Educational Services on the Healthy Hampshire team, and I live in Northampton, and I've been a part of the startup circle.
Thanks, Kristen. Rosanna?
Hi, all. My name is Rosanna Salazar, and I am a community engagement and evaluation specialist working at the Collaborative for Educational Services. I live in Amherst, and my pronouns are she, her.
Thanks, Rosanna. Roz?
Hi, everyone. My name is Roz Malkin. I live on Damon Pond in beautiful Chesterfield. And I'm a volunteer with the Food Policy Council and the Hilltown Mobile Market. Thanks.
Thanks, Roz. Next up is Sue.
Hi, I'm Sue O'Rourke. I live in West Hampton. I'm retired, luckily, and love working with the Food Policy Council. And I'm connected to West Hampton Connects. Thanks.
Sweet. Thank you, Sue. Well, now that you know us, let me back up. We also have guests from our department, Clark Banker and Sue Karen, who have been supporting us throughout this process and are joining us in the session today. So shout outs to them. Next, now that you know us, we'd love to get to know you. So please use the chat to share your name, any organizational affiliations that you'd like to share, what town you live in, if you'd like, and your preferred pronouns. Sweet. And as folks are doing that, I'll start talking a little bit about what our agenda is going to look like. So here's a plan for our meeting. In a moment, we'll ground ourselves with a land acknowledgement, and then we'll be transitioning to an icebreaker with our first limerick, written by Roz and with help from Sue. Next, we'll get into breakout groups of two or three for a brief icebreaker. And then when you come back, you'll be able to hear from each other and others in our community about the icebreaker topic, which is a surprise, but it'll be really fun. After that, you'll hear a bit about how we got to this point and who has been involved. Then we'll take a short break before we share more about our future plans for the Food Policy Council. Next, you'll be able to digest what you've learned in a breakout group where you'll get a taste of the decision-making method we use. And then we'll come back together and wrap up some key information. I also encourage you to feel free to use the chat and reaction options to actively engage with and affirm what folks are saying or things that resonate with you. If you go to your chat or go to the bottom bar, if you're on a computer, you'll be able to see reactions and they have a bunch of fun little emojis, as well as the chat should also include emojis. So feel free to use those as things come up for you and whatnot. Now I'm passing it over to Andy, who will introduce our land acknowledgement.
Thank you, Talia. For some time, we've been committed to a land acknowledgement, and I would say that that's a work in progress. The land acknowledgement that you'll hear was brought to the group. It was endorsed by the Nolambika Project, and we're in the process now of reviewing that land acknowledgement and thinking about the many communities that have been impacted by the taking of lives, land, and labor, and also how to bring forward a sense of thankfulness for where we are and who we are together in this place. So I'll turn it now to Rosanna, who will read our land acknowledgement. She'll be reading in Spanish. I invite you to go to that globe where it says, if you're on the English channel where it says EN, go to that button again and select the Spanish channel if you would like to hear the land acknowledgement in Spanish. When you're done, be sure to come back to the English so that you can hear the rest of the meeting. Go ahead, Rosanna. Thank you.
We acknowledge that we are on colonized ground, appropriated through a series of actions intended to destroy, seize, or diminish indigenous people, culture, and resources. We deeply consider historical realities, the impacts of settler colonialism, and how profit and harm still derive from these events. In response, we affirm Native American identities in this community today and a vibrant cultural legacy. We respectfully support the healing and restoration that is underway. We yearn for a genuine peace in our time and for generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rosanna. So today is really about sharing the story of the Food Policy Council, of how we came to be and the work that we hope to be a part of, working toward food justice in Hampshire County. And we're going to tell you our story in a bunch of different ways, including through poetry. Roz Malkin, with help from Sue O'Rourke and other members of the Startup Circle, have written limericks. And today we'll be sort of introducing each chapter of our story with a limerick. And each limerick will be accompanied by a video that was put together by Talia Segoba. And we hope that you'll enjoy them. I'm gonna pass it to Roz to start us off, and Roz will actually read our first limerick live to welcome us to the space today.
Thanks, Kristen. It gives me so much joy to be able to share these limericks with all of you today. So here we go. Limerick number one. We're so delighted to see all of you here. Thanks for your willingness in lending your ear. We hope that you find goals of like mind as we guide food systems to a new frontier. Take it away, Kristen.
Thank you, Roz. So now we would like to give you all a chance to meet each other. So we're going to do a short meet and greet icebreaker activity, and we'll break folks out into groups of two or three. And so you know, there won't be a facilitator in the room. So just feel free to unmute yourself, introduce yourself. And we've got a couple of prompts that we'd love for you to discuss. So the prompts are, what thoughts or feelings does food evoke for you? And why did you decide to come today? So we'll have, let's see, maybe about 7 or so minutes in the breakout rooms. And Caitlin will send us off momentarily.
Sorry about that. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and open all the rooms, and you should get a message saying that you are invited to a room. So just go ahead and click to accept the invitation. Here we go.
This meeting is being recorded.
All right, thank welcome you, back,
thank
everybody.
Thank you, Roz and Barbara. I didn't get to say goodbye.
Classic breakout room cutoff situation. Welcome back. I hope you made a new friend, had a nice conversation. As you're coming back into the room, we would love to just have you reflect for a second on the conversation that you just had and think about one word or phrase or feeling, something that resonated with you from the conversation you just had, and just pop it in the chat and press enter so that we can kind of see some of the feelings and thoughts and ideas that came out of your conversations. Food is love. I love that. Social determinism. Okay. Food is love, tradition and health, food as medicine, food is family, belonging, community, health, community, worries about COVID and the future of food, it's complicated, family ties to farming, collaboration, food means nostalgia, food is adventure, community-driven collaboration, empathy, these are great, sharing food with people, Food is common ground for tying us together. Oh, these are beautiful. These are just exactly the feelings that many of us have had when talking about this work. La comida es una aventura. See, food is an adventure. I love that. I love that adventure idea. Feel free to keep popping things into the chat if you're still having, you know, reflections on those conversations. But I'll keep us moving ahead here, and I'm going to pass it now to Rosanna.
Thank you, Christine. It's great to know why you are here today and why food is important to you. We wanted to have some of voices from our broader community here to answer those same questions. We asked people in our community to submit videos, which we edited together, and this is what they had to tell us. Because my work with the community, I have been able to closely experience food insecurity. This project will be our opportunity to create together and in harmony a future that we all long for food security and all that this implies. With the pandemic, we have new challenges, but working together with the community, the government, and the private sector, and with empathy, we will achieve it.
I was born in Malaysia and lived there until I was 8. The people who looked after me and my parents were Chinese, Malay, Tamil Indian, and Taiwanese. As a 5 or 6 year old, I remember most nights eating my traditional supper, going to bed, and then my parents leaving for some social event. As soon as they were gone, I would visit, sit with, chat, and eat food prepared for and by Maria, Alma, Cookie, and their children. This experience has had a long-lasting impact on me. I learned that eating food with friends provides a real and true sense of belonging.
Food is love, food is joy, food sustains us, and food ought to be a fundamental human right for every single person on this planet. And unfortunately, even in this country, tens of millions of people don't know where the next meal is going to come from. So if we understand the importance of food and the value of food, we need to double our efforts to try to end hunger and food insecurity and nutrition insecurity in this country. And I'm dedicated to that, and I know all of you are as well.
What does food mean to me? The first thing I think of when I think of food is love. Food is love. It's community, it's gathering, it's family, it's mani and pasta to make homemade gnocchi, it's hot pepper flakes, it's smoky cinnamon and coffee, it's gathering, it's a way to come together, and it's joy.
Food is everything to me. Food is the systems that we live in. Food is our liberation. Food is our systems of oppression. It can be anything we want, and it's such a good thing to spend our time on. And I have been wanting there to be a food policy council in Hampshire County for 6 years now, and the fact that it is finally happening makes me feel like this.
And that's to you, Kia. Oh, you're muted, Kia.
Okay, so now I'm going to share with you about how the FPC got to where it is today. We will start with another limerick to introduce the history and development of the Food Policy Council.
Many months ago, they formed a new group, gathering together in a momentous swoop. The focus was food and how to include more community folks in the FPC soup.
Okay, is that me now? I do my thing?
Yep, that's you. Go ahead.
Okay, So as you can see, this is a picture of our garden group from a couple of years ago. So one day in early 2019, two people, Caitlin Marquis and Clark Bankert, came to Hampshire Heights and asked if we were interested in having a community garden built so we could grow our own food right here where we live. Local institutions were funding it to promote healthier eating among a population of people experiencing food insecurity. Of course, there were many who loved the idea, and the raised beds went in, and that summer we grew many things. In the fall, our garden friends came back to Hampshire Heights and asked if we were interested in forming a cooking club where we could share the recipes and dishes we made with the food we grew, as well as food that we were receiving through Groford Northampton's mobile market coming weekly to Hampshire Heights. It sounded fun to us, so that fall we gathered in the community room and did exactly that. It was such a success that it became a permanent event on Friday evenings. We had a sense of community, made new friendships, celebrated birthdays, and ate really well. Following the success of our Friday night potlucks, as we started calling it, our friends again came to us and offered training in a new way to organize and make decisions. After a 10-week course in sociocracy with our sociocracy coach, Andy Grant, we were shown a diagram of what a potential food policy council might look like using this new method of governance. At the time, I thought this was hypothetical, but it quickly turned into a reality just as the pandemic hit and we were all isolated. All the progress we have made to create this body of work, everything you see here today, decide on the governance structure, then set it up and launch what you're all witnessing, happened on Zoom. During the last 2 years, some partners have had to drop out, new partners came in, but there is a core group of people who work their tails off to bring a structure capable of handling problems, any problems, disagreements, and objections with grace. We can also handle a variety of projects happening simultaneously depending on the need. Our method of working has created an extraordinary level of love and trust amongst the group. Even though the process was slow at times, we have set up an organization ready to tackle the hard work of food insecurity and the policies that create those problems. We hope our work will ultimately lead to better outcomes for the people that deserve to eat healthy and fresh food. Thank you.
All right. So I'll just fill in some background because it's great to hear Kia's perspective because it just shows how the work that we at Healthy Hampshire and the Collaborative for Educational Services were doing, how that work was landing in the community and how folks like Kia were experiencing it. But there was a lot going on prior to Kia's involvement that and in the background that led up to the story that Kia shared. So I wanted to share a little bit of that background. So in 2017, we had done a countywide food access assessment, and we brought together a food access advisory committee of community members experiencing food insecurity and also professionals who were working to address it. And we asked those folks to help us prioritize solutions to the challenges around food security that we were seeing in Hampshire County. So that group prioritized all of the strategies that Kia talked about, community gardens at affordable housing complexes, resident-led culinary education, and what we're doing now, establishing an inclusive countywide food policy council. So the establishment of this food policy council is really just one more step in our efforts to carry out that plan that we established back in 2017. But there have also been a lot of other steps along the way that we've taken to carry out that plan. And one big example is all of our work on mobile farmers markets that many might be familiar with. So we've helped to establish mobile farmers markets in Northampton, Amherst, and the Hilltowns. And we've also established community advisory committees to guide the implementation of those projects. So many of the folks who have been involved in that work along the way are here in this room, which is just really great. It's just the culmination a lot of the work that we've done. And we're just so grateful to have the partnership of residents like Kia and also all the organizational partners who have been, both informing and contributing to this work as we've gone along. And now I will pass it to Kristen.
Thank Thanks, Caitlin. So yeah, now we are actually going to talk a little bit about the organizations that have supported the development of the Food Policy Council so far. And again, like I mentioned, we'll start this part with another chapter of our story and another limerick that highlights our values around diversity, inclusion, and compassion for each other.
Empowerment and inclusion were emphasized. Shared power and unity were to be the prize. Diversity, oh yes, how this was stressed, as compassion and support were frequent replies.
Is that me?
Yep, back to you.
Okay, thank you. So none of this would be possible without the organizational partners who initially came together to bring this vision to life. And I think, Karen, we need to advance the slide to show who those folks are. So the development of the Food Policy Council really started with these organizational partners. Give me a second here. It started in earnest when Cooley Dickinson took the lead on applying for a grant from the Health Policy Commission, along with us at the Collaborative for Educational Services, the Hilltown Community Health Center, and Hilltown Community Development, or otherwise known as, or formerly known as Hilltown Community Development Corporation, which I still call Hilltown CDC for short. I don't know if that's right or not. So I will let Taylor from the Health Policy Commission, Jeff from Cooley, Kim from the Health Center, and Dave from the Hilltown CDC introduce themselves in a minute. But first, I just wanted to express my deep gratitude to all four of these partners. It's just been incredible to see all of these partners really dive headfirst and into following the community's lead and embrace that idea for this project. I just see how deeply each of these individuals really wants to hear from those most negatively impacted by our food system. And I just can't thank them enough for really wholeheartedly supporting the vision of a community-driven food policy council. So Taylor, Jeff, Kim, and Dave, would you each like to unmute yourselves and say a few brief words about your organization's role in this work, starting with Taylor, then Jeff, then Kim, and then Dave.
And hi, everyone. I'm Taylor Jolly, and I'm an associate at the Massachusetts Health Policy Commission. And I support the Hampshire County Food Policy Council by making sure they're maintaining our grant requirements for the Mass Up program, which supports and funds partnerships between healthcare organizations and communities who are focused on addressing root causes of health inequities, like Hampshire County Food Policy Council definitely is.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Jeff Harness from Cooley Dickinson, and we are the grant recipient, and we handle invoices, payment, reporting, participate in trainings, and otherwise stand back and watch with appreciation all the great work the community is doing.
Hi, I'm Kim Savory. I live in Middlefield, but I work for Hilltown Community Health Centers as their Director of Community Programs. And I am so delighted to be a part of this launch. You know, over the years, we have all worked to advance the idea of increasing access to affordable, healthy food and looking at that. And this has been such a lovely journey. Our work really is in support of the folks who are at the core of the council. We have done some work being sort of the clinical connection to those community activities and in a couple of different ways, many of which haven't been defined yet, but one of the ways I can think about is our community health workers screen folks for food insecurity, and then doing not only direct interventions, but referrals around that. But I could go on, but I am going to pass it to Dave.
Thank you, Kim. How's everybody doing? My name's Dave Christopoulos. I'm the executive director at Hilltown Community Development. And it's a pleasure to be a part of this project. I started getting involved in this early on in the history of this whole thing. And it's not business as usual for those of you who might be coming for the first time to check this out. This is truly a grassroots project, and it's something that I long for in this work. And I really enjoyed a lot of the planning meetings that we've had. Most of them have been online in the last 2 years, but it truly is different than what I'm used to working in the nonprofit sector. And I think that when we can really engage folks in our community and that they can be a part of the decision-making process, that's not the way we usually do things. And so it's a pleasure to be a part of that. And I hope that it, you know, kind of influences other organizations and other groups, because this is really the way that we got to be doing things. So Hilltown Community Development is 100% committed to this. And the last thing I'll say is, you know, we wouldn't have been as successful as we currently are without the partners in this group that we're talking about right now, but really with the staff at CES and how they've really helped coordinate and weave this all together. And, you know, we have a successful mobile market in the Hilltowns that didn't exist 4 years ago, but we put it together because we had support from the community and from this group. And we're moving a lot of food to people in the Hilltowns as a result of this. So I know this is the kickoff thing, but a lot has been done. And I'm very grateful for all of the support that we've received in the Hilltowns. So thank you very much for doing this and for allowing me to be a part of it.
Thank you, David. Thank you, everyone else, for introducing yourselves. Now we'll take a 5-minute break. We invite you to get up, stretch, get some water, use the bathroom, do whatever you need to do. If you'd like to stay here with us, Karen will also be playing a 5-minute meditation video, not a mediation video, that you can also follow along with, but again, do what's best for you.
Hey there, and thanks for gifting yourself these next few minutes. It's important to remember that you're a priority, and allowing yourself even just a few short minutes of intentional reflection can really have a positive impact on the rest of your day. So let's use these next few minutes to come back to center and set an intention for the rest of your day. Move into a comfortable position, whether you're seated at your desk at work or laying on the couch at home, and gently close your eyes and shift all of your attention onto your breathing, taking slower, deeper breaths than you've taken all day so far. Taking a deep breath in through your nose and slowly letting it out through your mouth. And continuing to breathe that way, feeling your lungs expand out as you inhale and contract back in as you exhale. Tune into your body, noticing how it feels, noticing if there's anything that it's trying to tell you. Notice any place of tension or tightness in your body. Give those areas permission to relax, sending love into those areas. Thank your body for taking such good care of you, and let it know that it's okay to rest and relax for these next few minutes. You may notice that your mind starts to wander off. That's okay. That's natural. Just notice it and bring your attention back to your body, using your breath as your anchor. Try to picture one thing that's happened today that's made you smile or made you thankful or appreciative. And just let that feeling fill you up for a moment. Breathe that feeling in from the top of your head to the tips of your toes. And allow yourself to smile if that feels natural. Now focus on something that you can do today, whether it's for yourself or for someone else, that will allow you to continue feeling this way. It could be something as small as deciding to go to bed early tonight, so that you have time to finally read that book that's been on your bedside table. Or the joy of getting dinner with a close friend. What's one little thing you can plan for your day to focus on that for a few minutes? Sit in that feeling of joy and peace. Let's take a few more deep breaths together. A deep breath in, feeling your lungs expand out as you inhale, and everything contract back in as you exhale. Again, an even deeper breath than the one before it, holding that breath for a beat, and exhaling everything out. Last time, your deepest breath yet, sending that breath through your entire body. And exhale it out. And in your own time, slowly bring your awareness back to where you are. And thank yourself for taking these few minutes to just be intentional and kind to yourself. And when you're ready, you can gently open your eyes and enjoy the rest of your day.
Welcome back, everyone. I hope you all had a great break. We also forgot to mention at the start that there is another important partner in the Startup Circle who has been such an important part of this work, Yohani Valerio. She couldn't be here today because of a family emergency, but we have her here in spirit, and we'll hear from her in a video a little bit later on. Now, we'll get started with hearing more about how the Hampshire County Food Policy Council works. First things first, what is a Food Policy Council? A Food Policy Council consists of a group of representatives and stakeholders from many sectors of the food system. Generally, they're made up of professional folks who have interests in food justice. The Hampshire County Food Policy Council is unique because it's been intentionally founded and led by community members who have been directly impacted by food insecurity or otherwise systemically excluded from decision-making around food. The founding members of the FPC understand that it is critical to center those most impacted by food apartheid in Western Massachusetts and work to build the power of those folks to influence policies and initiatives that promote food justice. This has been core to the development of the vision and mission of the FPC, which is what our next Limerick focuses on.
We discussed values, visions, and missions galore. And food as medicine was eagerly explored. The goal was for change, both short and long range. All the work being done was never a goal. Building relationships was the heart of our work, even suiting each other when going berserk. The launch is so near, best set aside that be. Healthy food for all will be the best bet.
Sweet Limerick. Next up, we have Sue, who will be talking about the FPC's vision. Sue, take it away.
Our vision describes the future we want to see and our shared set of values.
A small group of people, or what we call a helping circle, worked tirelessly for 2 months and gathered input from several community voices and sources to write the vision. A resilient, community-owned, regional food system where all people are empowered to live more joyful and gratifying lives through access to affordable, healthy, locally grown food of their choice. It is our North Star guiding us in all we do. So now I'll pass to KC, who will talk about the mission.
The Food Policy Council is rooted in building the power of community voice to reach the vision that Sue just shared. Our mission states we are doing this by cultivating shared governance and a countywide network to make food policies more equitable, honor diverse cultures, and help local food economies flourish. Here's Andy to speak on our circle structure governance known as sociocracy. Take it away, Andy.
To enact our vision and mission, the group has worked hard to center the voices of community members and to create a self-governance structure that helps us communicate and share decision-making. We continue the story with another stanza of our limerick.
Governance by consent, we finally agreed. Sociocracy was the choice we all decreed. Using circles and rounds, our voices did resound. Though at a slower speed, all knew we'd succeed. Members became leaders as we encouraged one another. Our hopes for the future carried each by the other. Zooming here, zooming there, no more zooming, we'd swear. Then 'twas off in search of more to discover. With coordinators, facilitators, and able scribes, these roles were selected without any bribes. Learning came soon, like a rising moon. The process moves forward as food needs prescribe.
And now I'll pass it to Roz to talk about our values.
Values. They're the fundamental beliefs that guide our actions. They reflect the heart and soul of who we are and why we do what we do. On the screen are two word clouds. The one on the left shows values that were created at an early learning circle by community participants as they thought about the formation of a food policy council. The word cloud on the right shows the 11 values that our FPC chose to guide our food system change efforts. And these values are, as you can see, inclusion, health, community, flexibility, equity, responsibility, justice, love, fellowship, empowerment, empathy, and joy. We anticipate that our values will probably evolve over time as our work expands and intensifies, but this ought to give you a good feel for what the FPC is about. Now I'll pass it back to Andy, who will talk about how these values guided our choice to use sociocracy as our governance structure.
The choice of sociocracy wasn't obvious. It took us many months of carefully listening, surveying all the possibilities, and selecting sociocracy as our operating system. I want to describe sociocracy to you to give you an idea. I like to talk about it as the slow cooking of community organizing. Literally, sociocracy is governance by people who associate together. And I appreciate that in practicing sociocracy, we don't go ahead over any member's objection. So if you look at this diagram here, there are things that we love in the middle, things that we like, and then there are things that are outside of that range things that we cannot work with, that raise an objection because they interfere with the aim, the thing that we've all gotten together to do. In sociocracy, objections are welcome. They add information, they give a different perspective. We respectfully receive the objections and integrate them into the proposal until we get to a place that everybody can work with it. Everything you're hearing about today is consent built. All of the statements, the vision, the mission, the circle structure, even the design of this program today, people got together in small teams and thought about what was possible and then went ahead when we reached consent. The next slide will show the possibilities of connecting as a partner with the Food Policy Council. We have the inner working circle where people will receive training in sociocracy, an orientation to a circle of their choice, and the possibility of becoming a working member of a small team. And then beyond that, we have network partners, a whole constellation of people who are interested in this work going forward and can support it in many ways. The next slide shows the circle structure that the startup circle has been thinking about and creating and building over the last many months. This includes core circles. The core working circles are the food policy circle, the food action circle, and capacity building. So food policy is, if we want to change legislation around food access, this would be a group that would talk about it and bring an action to affect policy change. Food action would be something like a mobile market, or a cooking club, or a community garden, where people in a certain location are doing things on the ground and supporting one another in that process. Capacity building is training and support of many types that helps people to do the work that they are agreeing to do. We'll go to the next slide. We're excited to offer trainings. There's core training in sociocracy and implicit bias training. We feel that implicit bias is built into our socialization. We've all been taught values and ways of perceiving people in society that might inhibit our work. So this is a chance to put ourselves on a common ground of understanding and care for the whole community. The sociocracy training is offered on February 8th and February 15th. The primary training is 3 hours on February 8th, followed by a debrief of that training. If you can't attend the training, Caitlin will put in the chat now a link to an self-directed online training that will give you a basic overview that you can go through on your own time, step by step. It's called Moose. Likewise, we have implicit bias training offered on February 22nd and a follow-up discussion on March 1st. The implicit bias training is through the Kirwan Institute and includes the self-assessment on implicit bias that Harvard University has developed over many years. If you'll go to the next slide, Karen, thank you. So we're excited to share the resource that was recently built, a website for the Food Policy Council. And on that site, if you go and visit, you'll see the self-guided experiences that are available to you, both in sociocracy and implicit bias training. Now I'll pass it to Rosanna, who will share about her experiences working with sociocracy.
Thank you, Andy. This is a clip from the International Sociocracy Conference that Startup Circle partners attended virtually in May 2021. Together, we led a session on the value of using sociocracy and the lessons we have learned through this process. Please play the video, Karen. Thank you.
Bueno, para nada, yo soy Joanny. No hablo español, o sea, no hablo inglés, hablo español. Y soy miembro del Consejo de Justicia Alimentaria, igual con mis compañeros aquí. De la sociocracia, para mí ha sido algo maravilloso porque al principio, cuando conocí la sociocracia, incluso el nombre se me hacía tan difícil pronunciarlo, sociocracia. Yo decía, pero qué extraño, yo no me escuché esa palabra. Cuando Andy por primera vez nos habló de la sociocracia, pero después que ya integramos en un grupo y Andy nos habló de cómo era el proceso y ya se implementó la sociocracia a este grupo de gobernanza, ha sido maravilloso porque ha sido un gran aprendizaje donde aprendemos a tener un poco más de paciencia, a saber escuchar a los demás, a que toda persona tienen valor, o sea, tienen al que darle su tiempo. Es como, para mí es como una, como algo en familia, algo diferente a otras reuniones, que tú te sientes más en confianza, como si estuviera en casa, que la persona que tú ves ahí, aunque sean personas, o sea, con un rango diferente de profesión y quizá uno se siente que no o sea, que no llega igual que ellos, pero cuando tú estás en la conversación de la sociocracia en este grupo, nos sentimos con el mismo poder, como con una equidad igual, o sea, como nos sentimos, yo me siento como si fuera en el mismo nivel, aunque no tuviera la misma preparación, por la oportunidad que se nos da de expresarnos, de ser libre, de hablar lo que sentimos, de que no haya diferencia. Por ejemplo, en mi caso, yo hablo español y yo me siento muy orgullosa porque con el apoyo que me dan, porque o sea, del grupo, yo sí que Rosana habla español, pero domina su inglés perfectamente, yo no. Yo soy la única que solamente domino el español y se me da mucha ayuda, me siento orgullosa porque piensan en mí, me ponen intérprete, incluso hasta más de uno, y yo me siento como, o sea, eso me dio como más empoderamiento como persona para sentirme más útil, o sea, me ha ayudado mucho más porque debo decir, me siento como si yo estuviera con mi familia apoyándome, que cuando caigo me levantan y que cuando me siento abajo me paran, o sea, y me empujan, entonces, o sea, la sociocracia para mí ha sido eso, como una diferencia, como, o sea, que tú en una reunión donde se resuelven los problemas, donde nada se quede en el aire, donde se le da oportunidad a cada persona de expresarse, donde la persona si tiene algo que no le gusta, no se tiene que quedar con ellos, sino que se lo expresa, uno se siente con esa libertad de expresarlo, no se queda con timidez, no se siente encogido, porque la sociocracia me da la libertad de hablar, o sea, de decir, oh, yo no lo voy a decir porque ¿qué van a decir? No, nos da confianza. La sociocracia nos da esa confianza, nos da ese apoyo, o sea, nos da ese entendimiento, esa calidez humana, nos da esa calidez humana que quizá, aunque la tengamos, no la expresamos en otra clase de reunión porque el proceso es más rápido. La sociocracia, el proceso es más lento, pero es mejor porque hay más comunicación, hay más apoyo, o sea, se te da el tiempo, se te da la oportunidad de expresarte, se te toma en cuenta. Eso es algo que debería, ahora que yo conozco la sociocracia, debería de haber existido desde antes. Incluso debería existir hasta en los gobiernos para que, si se existiera, por ejemplo, los proyectos de gobierno, sería muy diferente, porque hubiera equidad en todos los lugares. O sea, hubiera esa equidad, esa oportunidad de que la persona pueda expresarse, de escuchar la voz de todo el mundo.
Thanks, Rosanna. And yeah, you got a chance to meet Joanny, our Startup Circle partner who couldn't be here today, speaking so beautifully about how sociocracy has impacted her experience working in the Food Policy Council. And we just love that video because it just captures Joanny's essence, but also the essence of why this group has chosen this particular self-governance method and why we feel so passionate about it, why we're asking folks to spend a little bit of time getting trained and to practice this particular method, because we really do believe it. It helps us to share power and equalize voices in our group. And that's really at the core of what this group is about, getting professionals and food system stakeholders together with community members with lived experience of food insecurity to share decision-making power about how we move toward food justice in Hampshire County. So we know that we have shared a lot of information with you. We've just dropped a whole bunch of links into the chat that you can access even more information about our trainings, about sociocracy, and find our website where there's more information about those circles that Andy shared with you, and a lot more. So we thought that we might spend some time actually breaking out into small groups and giving you a chance to ask questions, share your reactions, continue to get to know each other a little bit, just spend some time together. And we'll actually be sort of doing this in the spirit of sociocracy. So you will have a facilitator in your group who will be a member or a partner of the startup circle. You'll notice we use the word partner instead of member, which was another intentional choice that the group has made on how we want to call ourselves. So you'll have a startup circle partner with you in the room, and they will kind of guide you through what we call a round, which is a chance for each individual to speak and sort of share what you're thinking, share your reactions, your questions, and the facilitator will either try to answer your question. If they don't know the answer, they'll open it up to the group and see if anybody else knows the answer. And if there is no answer to be found in the group, then the facilitator will jot down your question and we'll be compiling those to share at our second session and probably in an email follow-up to this session. So we've got a couple of prompts that are sort of what I just said, but what are your thoughts or reactions to what you've learned and heard about today? And do you have any questions? So we'll give everyone a chance to share, and you can always choose to pass if you'd like, if you don't want to speak or for whatever reason, you don't have your thoughts collected, you can always pass. But we really encourage you to participate and just sort of share what's on your mind. And that's kind of what's at the root of this governance structure that we use is speaking and sharing what's on our minds. So I think we'll have about, miraculously somehow, this something is happening that never happens on Zoom meetings, which is we are ahead of schedule. So I have no clue how we've managed that, but we have allotted about 25 minutes for this breakout, and there'll be about 8 people in each room. So, we'll all have, 3 or 4 minutes to speak. So I think we'll stick with the 25 minutes and come back together. And then we might have a little bit of time to actually sort of just check in on how people, what people talked about, but it looks like 5 to 6 people in each room. Okay. So we'll have a little bit more space for each person to talk as well. So I'm just checking my notes here, and all of our startup circle partners are ready to go ahead and facilitate and lead you in the round. So I think we can go ahead and break out, and we'll come back together in about 25 minutes. In our group. And I think Talia is actually going to welcome us back formally.
Sweet. Thank you, Kristen. Welcome back, everyone. I hope that was a good opportunity to get to know each other a bit better and have some good conversations about what the FPC is, how we work together, and how you might get involved. We're going to start wrapping up right now. So first, we will share the final stanza of our limerick read by Roz. Then we will hear from Caitlin about how to make sure you're registered for part two of our launch next week, as well as a few more announcements about how to find more information in the meantime. Roz, take it away.
Thanks, Talia. I finally got myself unmuted. We've accomplished so much and come a long way. Our creative new process is now here to stay. Please join in with us as we ride the food bus, and all will be seated for a new lifestyle buffet.
Hey, thank you so much, Roz. I think we all just have to really give it up for Roz for writing all of those awesome limericks. I know she had some help from Sue O'Rourke as well, but it was just such a fun idea that Roz had to kind of guide us through this meeting. So yeah, definitely, I can't see everybody, but I encourage your reactions, your celebrations, your hand claps and all that for that hard limerick work that turned out so great. Yeah. So you've gotten to know a bit about us tonight. You've gotten to know our mission, our vision, our values, our history, and hopefully you've gotten to know each other a little bit too. Sue, I see that you raised your hand. Did you want to jump in with something?
It was a mistake.
Okay. All right. No worries. So our next session will be next Tuesday, a week from today, on January 25th, and it will be from 1 to 3 p.m., so it's a little bit earlier in the day, and it will be an opportunity to think about how you specifically, whoever you are coming to this meeting, might like to engage in the Food Policy Council's work. So where do you want to plug in? And so if you're interested in joining the council, becoming a partner in the council, we really hope you'll attend this session. And if you haven't registered for it yet, you can do so at our website, which is hcfpc.collaborative.org. I think Kristen's going to drop that into the chat for you. And I will just say it's going to be, much more of a working session. And so the other thing I'll just note is that if there's anybody you know who you think might be interested in getting involved in the Food Policy Council and they weren't able to come to this session, that's really not a big deal because we're going to record it. We recorded this session and we'll share out that recording and then folks can watch this session, explore our website, whatever they might need to do to get the background on the Food Policy Council before participating on the session in the session on the 25th. And so if you know folks who you think really would like to get involved, that's really going to be a great session to be at. So please encourage them to be there. And please try to make it yourself if you can. So if you're feeling ready now, and you don't even need to come to next session to become a part of the Hampshire County Food Policy Council, you either as a network partner or working circle partner, a network partner being, just sort of somebody who is invited, regularly as a guest and sort of stays in touch with the network, or a working circle partner being an actual decision maker in the Food Policy Council. You can go ahead and fill out the network interest form on our website, which is under the Get Involved tab. I saw Kristen that pasted it into the chat with the directions to paste it into the chat.
Oopsie.
I love it. A little peek behind the curtain there. So using this form, you can let us know what level of involvement you're interested in. Also any supports that you might need to participate. So if you need a stipend, interpretation, transportation or childcare for future in-person meetings, that form is your opportunity to let us know about whatever supports you might need, and we will do our very best to support you to engage. So you can also use our website to register for the foundational trainings that Andy mentioned. Those are the ones that we're asking all Food Policy Council partners to participate in. So you can just navigate to the training and orientation page under resources, or if you have any, and I think maybe Kristen will paste that link in the chat. But if you have any issues registering for the trainings as well, you can also contact us at foodpolicycouncil@collaborative.org, which Kristen will put in the chat. And the final thing, the second to final thing I'll say, but although I want to interrupt myself because I see Casey has her hand raised. Casey, did you want to jump in with something?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask if people who are considering joining the Food Policy Council will have access to the Google Drive documents.
Yes, people who fill out the network interest form and say that they want to become a Food Policy Council partner, we will give them access to the Google Drive, yes.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, thanks, Casey, good question. So another thing I just wanted to say is that we really value continuous reflection, feedback, and improvement as part of our work. And so in this spirit, we want to invite you to give us feedback on this session, how it was for you. So you can either click on the link now that Kristen's dropping into the chat. You can also find that link on the calendar page of our website. It's underneath the registration for the event. And also, if you plan on going to our website and completing the network interest form, there's a link at the end of that form that will take you over to the session feedback form. So if you're going to fill out the network interest form anyway, you'll have a direct way to go to the session feedback form. And then finally, I just want to let you know that if you registered for this event, or if you've received any emails from us via MailChimp, you are already on our email list. So keep an eye out on your inbox for more information about our next launch session and also the upcoming trainings that we have scheduled. And that's it for my wrap up. So I will pass it to Rosanna to start off our closing.
Thank you, Caitlin.
Oh, Rosanna, you just muted yourself.
No, I muted her. It's my fault. I'm sorry, Rosanna.
Okay. Thank you, Caitlin. Let's remember that the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations states that every human being has the right to adequate nutrition and has the fundamental right not to suffer from hunger. Echoing to this and to our hearts, this project wants to ensure that Hampshire County communities have sufficient food, stable and long-lasting access to food, and be sure that this food is salubrious and life-giving. We believe this will help all people in our community to live a joyful and gratifying life. Ross.
Thanks, Rosanna. Food is sacred, food is life, and it's as important as breathing. Food connects us to each other, provides greater health, offers joy and celebration, and so much more. The sacred is also found in working together towards a higher purpose and greater compassion. As Rosanna and Congressman McGovern already stated, we all should have the right to healthy and affordable food. We hope you will join with us in fulfilling this basic right and creating positive change for all our communities. Thanks.
All right, and with that, we officially declare the Food Policy Council launched. So blast off.
Woo-hoo!
And we hope, as Roz and Rosanna said, that you will join with us, and we hope to see you at the next session. Have a good night, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
I'm going back to the south. I'm going back, 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 back. When my roots ain't watered down. Growing, growing like a bob-bob tree. All life on for the ground. Ancestor put me on game. On with my own shoon in a jail. Drip all on me. Uncle Dada, she keep friends. Hola, Yona, Stella, Sacha, not chopper, instant. Yeah, pure ice, 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 ice. Bust down, bloody, 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 bloody. On my wrist.